Okay, welcome back to track one of the Virtual Software Circus. I'm here with Adrian Cockcroft of AWS. Adrian is another one of our five-year alumni. Adrian spoke at the first Software Circus in, I believe, August or possibly September 2015. Welcome, Adrian.
It's good to see. Good to see you again. Good to be back.
Yeah, you too. Adrian's talk was billed as of shoes and ships and sealing wax of cabbages and kings, but in fact, there is no talk. It's going to be a conversation.
Well, I was the first speaker at the first Software Circus. And when I turned up, I was trying to think about it. I wasn't sure who was going to turn up or what people would want to hear about. So I kind of got the feel for that as I walked in the first day and gave my talk with no slides and started a little bit of a trend. It's the first time I'd done a fairly large talk to a large audience with no slides, just sort of things I thought was interesting. And then we started picking up some, a little bit of Q&A, some ideas from the audience. And then what actually seemed to happen at the time was that there was a tweet screen going on in the background, and we've got the chat session going here. And people started tweeting stuff that was references to what I was doing. So we ended up with my slides were live tweeted into existence behind me as I was speaking, and there is no video, no record of this other than you should have been there. And it went remarkably well considering it was all improv, basically.
Well, we don't have a Twitter stream this time other than Twitter itself, so I'm going to try to remember those things. But in a way, the conversation is perfectly set up because the last time we tried something like that, the Software Circus, was a long time ago, and a lot has happened in the meantime. I mean, Kubernetes was a thing somewhere. The CNCF didn't exist yet. I think, were you in 2015, were you still at Netflix, or had you already gone to AWS?
No, I was at Battery Ventures. I was working for a VC firm in between Netflix and AWS. I joined AWS at the end of 2016.
I also think serverless wasn't yet a thing, or perhaps it was only a thing, but there wasn't a conference. So maybe that's
There wasn't a conference, but Lambda came out in 2014, I think. So it was starting to take off.
So maybe that's a good way to frame this. You've been from Netflix through Battery, now AWS. You arguably have a inside sort of view on a lot of things that are happening here. Perhaps you could say what the most interesting or important changes have been for you in the software world in the last 5 years.
Sure, thanks for the setup. What I've been doing, well, about 3.5 years ago, I joined AWS and was really two roles. One is to go out and talk to a lot of customers and help them with their cloud transition and things like that. I also started a team to work on open source for AWS, and we created a Twitter handle, a website. We started turning up regularly at conferences, sponsored a few different organizations. There's an open source credits program from AWS. If you're working on a project, you need some credits. There's an application process on the website. So all that happened. Probably the thing that most people noticed was that we joined CNCF, and that happened in the summer of 2017. And you know, basically myself and Arun Gupta sort of just wrote the documents internally, convinced everyone, ganged up on everyone else. And it was one of those things where if you make a good argument, they go along with it. Mm-hmm. We had to raise some money that wasn't budgeted to join. And so that was the big thing. And it was before we figured we were going to have a Kubernetes product, EKS, but it was 6 months before we were ready to launch, but we had to kind of get something in the public sphere for the initial engagement with the process. So that was probably the most immediate thing that happened that summer. Arun was with us for about 3 years. He recently moved to Apple, where he's running their Kubernetes engagement and having a fun time there. So the nice thing about open source is that the way I think about it, there's a group of people that work on open source. And at various times, various large companies pay our wages. And we move around, and everything we do is helping the commons, right? It's a positive sum game. And everything that I do, or everything Kelsey Hightower does, everything Arun does, it's all helping open source. And because of that, it's not quite the same as the more competitive aspects of the computer industry. It's a place where everyone comes together and helps. So we're all good friends across all of the different cloud providers and various large end users. So it's been a nice environment to work in from that point of view.
Has open source changed over the last 5 years for you, if at all?
Well, 5 years ago, I guess I'd left Netflix by then. So with Netflix, we created an open source program because we'd got a little bit ahead of the rest of the industry and we wanted to share what we were doing to help people sort of fast follow us. That was one of the reasons. It was also trying to hire interesting people. There's a bunch of reasons for doing open source, wanting to give back. With AWS, there was a lot going on at AWS, but nobody was talking about it. So we've managed to get more interesting projects out of AWS, more contributions from AWS. I think there's still quite a long way to go, and more teams are doing more over time. But the trend is in the right direction, and we've got a much clearer set of ways of engaging now. So I think one of the things was AWS was a big untapped resource. There were a lot of engineers there. They weren't contributing as much to open source as they could, and we've been in the process of fixing that. So that's one thing. The other thing that's happened in open source is that there's a big rise in what you might call the end user as the creator of the open source project. It's not necessarily a startup that's doing an open source project. It's, you know, like LinkedIn created Kafka, Netflix created a whole bunch of Netflix OSS projects, Airbnb has created a bunch, Lyft has created a bunch, and then the major cloud providers are also creating things. So the source of funding for people to work on open source is a mixture of large end users who have a need that isn't being met, and the cloud providers who are sort of adopting some of these things and contributing. And then there's also the sort of pure play startups that have just created a thing and open sourced it. Mm-hmm. And they all mix together, and there's been a bit of jostling over the last year or two. But I think that the overall community is very healthy. There's a lot going on, there's a lot of investment. So it's been good to see. And really it's where most of the core innovation is happening. It's very hard now to bring out a new tool in enterprise IT which isn't open source. It's actually pretty difficult to get support for it. And it's a lot of work, and it probably needs to be something very innovative. I think one of the examples of that is probably Lambda, AWS Lambda, which is, it just, you know, there's bits and pieces around it that are open source, and there's a few clones and copies, but it's an example of something where AWS just got way out ahead of the pack with a new idea. And you'll still see things like that coming up. But the sort of me too, also run kind of things where you're just trying to disrupt the market, those things that tend to be open source nowadays. Yeah. Seeing a lot of that in databases particularly.
With all of these technological innovations, we see what's sometimes referred to as sort of a long tail of adoption, or perhaps just people getting through the trough of disillusionment after the hype cycle. Mm-hmm. We've had a lot of previous talks today about culture. And I wondered if you had any insights on how culture affects both a company's ability to adopt new technologies, but also the wisdom to know whether or not they should.
Yeah. I think there's a few ways of looking at that. One of the very unique things, I mean, because I come from Netflix, everyone wants to hear about the Netflix culture, and Netflix culture comes with a big warning on it saying, you can't actually copy this warning. In fact, it was deliberately hard to copy. That's one of the sort of tenets of the Netflix culture, is they want it to be hard to copy, so it becomes a sustained competitive advantage, which is very annoying if you're trying to copy Netflix, because they keep doing things that you can't do. The way HR runs and a whole bunch of things are just mind-blowing to most HR departments. And I left 7 years ago, so it's changed a little since. It's got a bit bigger as well, a lot bigger. But the thing that we were very good at in the early days was adopting new technologies as they came out, figuring out how to make them work and bending them to our needs, right? And you saw that with AWS as really the first big all-in customer of AWS. We gave AWS a huge amount of feedback and became one of their most critical customers. So that was one thing. But then you may not realize that DataStax, it was also pretty much their first customer or one of their first customers. So that's Cassandra. Mm-hmm. Nginx almost came into existence because Netflix started paying the guy that wrote it, and he needed to form a company to cash the checks and support Netflix. And so the whole Nginx became a large company. It had an exit. AppDynamics, I think we were pretty much the first customer for them too. Again, they had a nice big exit with Cisco. I'm trying to think, we're very early users of Workday. So we've got all the ERP and financials and all that stuff done there. I think there's another couple of that I can't think of. JFrog, so Artifactory, again, one of the early customers, an early customer for Atlassian. So if you look at the Netflix architecture and tools, Netflix is extremely good at and very brave in the sense that it's willing to try things. And if you look at those companies, it almost became that the venture capital firms wanted to see Netflix on your what they call the NASCAR slide, the one with all the logos on. And Netflix got very good pricing leverage because you almost like the benefit of having Netflix as a customer was the PR value was more than Netflix could pay you.
Right.
Clearly. So Netflix started getting good deals for things and also started shaping those products to meet their needs. And that as a cultural, it really comes from the culture at Netflix, which is a culture that innovation isn't something that happens in the research lab. It's the daily job of everybody at the company. And also that it was very devolved into the individual teams to find these tools and go and build things. And there's a lot of lot you can learn from taking that approach. But again, it's very hard to copy for a lot of organizations to do that. And I just want to go to one other thing around culture was I was very lucky last year to meet Mel Conway and actually spent a few days with him at a workshop. And Conway's law is one of those things that you hear, right? Mm-hmm. The architecture of the software will follow the shape of the organization that's building it.
Right.
And so if you want to build a microservices architecture and you're organized as a series of silos, you will build a distributed monolith because you just end up with a lot of people fighting with each other over that system. If you actually do what we call the inverse Conway maneuver, which is to set up the organizational structure that you think makes sense, and then the software architecture will follow from that. Each of the individual teams will build a clump of microservices, probably with a lead engineer on each, and the thing will just turn into that. The APIs between the teams become the APIs between the microservices. It's a very natural flow. And that's why Netflix built this architecture. And it's also the way AWS works. Something else I realized, people talk about the business, like there's the IT and then there's the business and IT works for the business. AWS doesn't think that way. There is no business. The business is the service team. So there's lots of tiny little businesses, each of which has effectively its own headcount, its own P&L, right. Its own roadmap, and product management, operations and development, and they're funded as almost a little startup. And AWS is basically hundreds of these little startups, all funded from a central group and just all working independently. And then you look at the APIs between those teams are the way that we communicate it across the organization. So that's sort of culturally, that's why we've seen a larger, more interest in these more distributed cultures, cellular, depending on whose books or articles you've read, maybe squads, things, there's different names for it. But that I think is the cultural thing that lets you innovate and move more quickly.
This question from the chat, which is actually quite a nice segue. I mean, there was a time I remember, especially around 2015, where it was sort of impossible to read anything that contained your name without the term microservices elsewhere in the sentence. And of course, as is usual, we've been through sort of hype and now there's a trough of disillusionment in some senses. Microservices are starting to take a bit of flack in some areas. Adrian Miller asks, when do you think, or can you provide any guidelines for when you think it's appropriate or inappropriate to adopt that architecture?
Yeah, so It was never intended to be, this is the only architecture. It's the right architecture for a distributed organization of a fairly large number of people who can no longer coordinate to build a single monolith. Mm-hmm. And there were some examples, particularly Etsy, that they managed to push it up to like 100 people working on a monolith. But that was really it was a lot of work, and it was very cleverly done. And most people couldn't copy the way they did it. When we hit about 100 people at Netflix in our web engineering team, that's when everybody was trashing everybody else's check-ins, and it just turned into a mess. So we had to break it apart because we were trying to scale the team that was working on it. So that's one thing. The other thing was the weight and the amount of work to do a release is fairly heavy for a monolith, and particularly if you have to deploy hardware, and you have to talk to operations, and you have to have meetings. So the data center sort of release cycle usually is a few weeks, mm-hmm. a week or two, even at best. With virtualization, it got a bit easier, but still it's work. When you go to API-driven cloud-based deployment, your deployment can be continuous. And so really it was continuous delivery also drives microservices, because you don't want to keep redelivering everything because you might break some piece of it that you weren't trying to change. So you need to break it down in order to do that. So it's generally the organizational things. So the people that are still building monoliths are the people that are dealing with it from an extreme efficiency and latency issue, because obviously breaking the system into pieces, there's more overhead. You've got more boundaries to cross to get between things, and the boundaries are what's giving you the agility, but also the cost of those boundaries is still a tax on the architecture.
Right.
So if you're trying to do ad serving, you probably have a monolithic system, because the ads have to appear on your web page before anything else. So you're staring at the ads while you're waiting for your actual mm-hmm. news item to load or whatever. Right. That's the whole point of ad. They need to be low latency. Some of the sort of high frequency trading, very low latency things, gaming, those tend to be monolithic, at least for the core user interaction piece. I think there's some interesting ways in which the latency between these microservices, as we reduce that, we end up building something that is more like an aggregated set of microservices that I think we're going to end up seeing a trend that they start behaving more like a monolith. As the networks get faster and the latency gets lower, and we find ways to bundle together a group of microservices extremely efficiently while still maintaining the separation boundary and the protections and the ability to do continuous delivery. There's some interesting stuff happening. I think the new Darklang stuff, where you're editing code that's running in production, mm-hmm. and so their commit to production is what, 50 milliseconds or something, is right. the time it takes to release to production. Just you just hit save on whatever you were editing. I think that's a really interesting idea. And it ties into something that Kent Beck's been talking about called TCR, or test commit revert. If you haven't seen that, he did a blog post on it a year or so ago. So the idea with this is you type some code in, you hit save, it automatically runs your tests. If it fails the tests, it deletes everything. It reverts all of the code you just entered. And you're staring at the code before you. So it forces you to do very incremental small updates, because if you type a page of code and you get one semicolon in the wrong place, you lost it all.
Right.
So the idea is it drives this extremely tiny incremental thing. And it's TCR is test and commit or revert, I think is the way he does it. Because you commit or revert depending on whether it passes the test.
The gamified approach to the correct behavior in software development, perhaps.
Yeah, and they've done a few workshops, and it's an interesting little community starting to build around it. So if you're really looking for the extremes of like, where are we going? I'd say that the commit to production, it's going to be ever smaller chunks of code. And right. and the overhead of getting it to production is reducing. It's pretty much zero already, but it's going to reduce to be effectively zero. And then you want to make lots of tiny changes. And the big thing that we've learned over the last few decades is that software doesn't scale. Complexity doesn't scale. You want to make the smallest change you can. and check that change independently of everything else. So the efficiency of doing lots of small changes is really the trend that we're on in terms of change management. And it, the risk and the probability of it working and the outcomes are just so much better.
Right. I wanted to touch on hybrid cloud for a moment. Depending on which analysts you listen to, the headline seems to be that absolute numbers of, let's say, compute moving to the cloud seems to be increasing still, but the acceleration, so the second derivative, is slowing. And it, this seems to be evidenced by AWS Outposts, VMware Tanzu, Red Hat OpenShift to some extent, and Google's Anthos. How do you see this shift?
What I see is a really interesting time because for a long time, cloud was a centralizing architectural move. We were going to take all of the computers in the world and put them in a small number of places. Right. And that works for a whole class of applications. But when you get into industrial control, or you want to put some compute on a ship, or say, one of I'll get onto another really interesting idea sort of for a workload. But what we found was that we really needed to be able to distribute the cloud. And what we're starting to see is cloud as now a distributed architecture. And a lot of the what we've learned about how to do cloud is now effectively being disrupted by this new idea. So now there's a network between your control plane and the machines you're running, and you have to figure that out. It's still API driven, but you now have to worry about capacity planning because you have to get the right amount of local capacity. If it's too small, it'll overload. If it's too big, you've wasted your money. So we've used to not have to worry about capacity planning in the cloud because you just use the machines when you need them and turn them off again.
Right.
So a bunch of the concerns that we'd thought, you know, I used to be a capacity planning expert. I was like, that was what I did at Sun Microsystems for a decade. And now I've had, oh, hey, I need to relearn how to do capacity planning. So we're going to have all sorts of capacity planning for your edge computing resources and kind of ideas going around. We have to dig off some old slide decks from 15, 20 years ago. That's old things keep coming back, right? So that's, so I think it's interesting, and you're seeing the trend. This is being driven by a number of, like, in the same way that Netflix was drove AWS to do a whole series of products and ways of working. We're working particularly with Volkswagen in industrial control, in industrial automation, and we're working with the large telcos like Verizon and Vodafone, and I think it's KDDI and another one in Korea. And it's SK Telecom, but those were the initial players because they want, so let's think of this scenario, you know, think about 5G. Where is 5G happening first in the world? As with all telecom introductions, Korea, mm-hmm. right? Like there is much more penetration of 5G in Korea. And then you think, well, where do a lot of the games in the world come from? Korea. Right. So you look at a gaming company in Korea building a 5G enabled gaming system that's tying everything together, very high bandwidth, low latency. Then you say, how do I deploy that into Europe? How do I deploy that into the US when I've tied it into some proprietary 5G stuff that KDDI or SK Telecom came up with? And so what we're doing with Outposts is we're delivering the same hardware to the telcos globally. Mm-hmm. And we have this layer on it called Wavefront, which is a set of APIs which are common too. So now you can deploy on the Wavefront APIs into the outpost. So you're sort of doing a very AWS native idea for your local support. And these machines are in the sort of effectively in the 5G based stations. And then you go to Europe or America and say, okay, it's still wavelength. It's still on the same hardware. We have a port, we built a portability layer. So we're not the only people doing this, but this is the AWS global telecom portability layer. And I just want to, there's one of my sort of mental models for what games would look like, one of the interesting ideas. So do you remember when we used to be able to go to stadiums before this virus came along?
I seem to.
Yeah, it was like Wembley Stadium or the Super Bowl or whatever, you know, there's all of these. Yeah, I used to go to Formula One races every now and again. Oh, well. Mm-hmm. So assuming we ever do that ever again, right, let's say 100,000 people one day turn up at Silverstone Racetrack or somewhere for a weekend. What happens from, what's the telco view of that? Right? How much telco infrastructure is there at Silverstone most of the year? It's not a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Right? How much is there for a race weekend? Or how much is there, Wembley's probably a better example because it's more permanent. There's stuff going on at Wembley probably every few weeks or whatever.
Yeah.
If we put in a huge pile of outposts at the base of Wembley Stadium and we hooked up a 5G cellular system around that, then everybody that's at the stadium would have access to local compute with like millisecond latency, interactive gaming, virtual reality. I don't know. It's easier to understand. American football, they're wearing big crash helmets, so you can put cameras in the helmets. I'm not quite sure where you stick the cameras on soccer players, but Formula One, obviously, it's easy. You stick stuff on the car. But the idea that you'd be able to have a real low latency immersive experience of your sport. And this is just so one of the ideas that's being sort of kind of enabled. So it's kind of an interesting vision of something that might be one of the killer apps for 5G and for gaming and get everyone back into that experience. And then, of course, people who don't want to go to the stadium because they're worried about getting a virus can do it over a network and maybe a 50 or 100 milliseconds latency that may be still closer. But you'd get a much more visceral experience if you were right there. So that's kind of, think of that as sort of a cloud-based application, which is going to come in probably, it may take a few years to get there, but those are the kinds of things that I think is an interesting thought experiment about what you could do with this sort of platform.
And it seems like, I mean, perhaps Wembley isn't the best example for what I'm about to say, because as you say, there are events there happening all the time. But if we imagine a Formula One, you know, once a year, a whole bunch of people turn up and you need to do various sorts of compute. Doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
Essentially, what this is turning into is a conversation around logistics. How do we get hardware in places quickly and then make it accessible in a way that's not nasty?
Yeah, the Formula One already do this. They fly a data center around the world and they ship the same machines race to race week after week. The Formula One logistics, there's a little gray tent stuck around the back of the track. If you ever get to see like the aerial view of a race, that's the communication center. I've actually had a little tour of it. There's a broadcast studio and lots of equipment for timing, and they wire up the whole track with fiber optics, and then it all gets gathered together. So if you ever think of, you've got a data center and you can just package it up and move it somewhere else in a week, they do that every week. So we have models for the logistics people we can learn from. But yeah, they do a pop-up. I mean, every telco for every race like that, they do kind of a pop-up telco infrastructure. There's lots of temporary base stations they put at major sporting events that are at sites that aren't used intensively. So that works a lot. I see a couple more questions here as well.
Yeah, it seems we've got one more question. There's a question about OpenCore business models. There's a question about other serverless frameworks. And there's a question about COVID. Yeah. You may choose from the above three.
I think the Knative is interesting. There's a variant on top of it, I think Trigger Mesh are building, which is attempting to make it look as much like Lambda as possible for the core APIs. I think my worry about that is if you think about how many layers of control plane you have to implement. So you've got your Kubernetes cluster, Kubernetes control plane, then you've got some Istio control plane, then you've got your Knative control plane, and then you're running your serverless app on top. Mm-hmm. How much infrastructure did you have to provision just to run a few functions? And how many functions per second can you actually run against Knative? I'd like to see what the cost per function invocation is for a Knative installation. You know, is it actually cost effective? That works for, there are some use cases for serverless, which are basically operations automation, like event-driven operations, and they're not really cost sensitive. So that kind of thing I could see working well with Knative. Running a mainstream serverless application, I don't really see it. We have customers running tens of thousands concurrency Lambda invocations pre-staged for flash sales.
Right.
And really hugely horizontally arranged. So that's tens of thousands of cores sitting there waiting for the next request to come in to run these things. So that those kinds of things I think wouldn't be cost effective and be hard to scale. So I think that there are certainly some places that Knative is interesting. And there's several different contenders in there, some of them more lightweight than others. But, and I think it's, you know, still most of serverless is still based around what AWS is doing. And then there's the rest of it is sort of a minority of smaller, sort of less mature implementation. So it's still moving pretty fast. I'm doing a talk later today, and this is running today and in a week's time, that AWS is running something called the serverless first function. So if you've spent all day watching Software Circus and you just want to be sitting in your chair watching more videos of people talking, Werner's up in another hour or two, and then I'm on in about 2 or 3 hours doing a talk on serverless first and why you should be doing all your work, all your development should be, try to do it serverless. If you can, use that as a prototyping mechanism.
Great. So that's a follow-up for you all, if you want to learn more about serverless. Unfortunately, we've run out of time. I feel like we could keep talking about this for hours, but thank you again for supporting us at the beginning and at the end of this 5-year journey.
Yeah, thank you. My killer sheep here says thank you as well. It's like sheep in wolf's clothing here.
I've only got one thing left to do, which is everyone else has had canned applause. So now you're going to get some.
Thank you.
Adrian Cockcroft, thank you very much for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Cheers.
Bye-bye.
Bye.